Hello everyone, this is Demetrius Wilson again. We're on slide 21 out of 31, so this will be a little bit shorter, or hopefully shorter, than the first video. But we'll finish off on this one. So we're going to start with speaking about creativity tools. So creativity tools inspires lateral thinking versus program thinking, right? Do you think lateral? Do you kind of think on the move? Or is your thinking very, very programmed? It involves a reflective and probing type of or style of asking questions, right? We need to get down to the nitty-gritty, know and understand what we're dealing with, create a good hypothesis, and then come up with an actual solution. So the following illustrates examples of how creativity can be fostered using what they call the Scamper framework. So definition, substitute what other ingredients, materials, times, or places can be used to create value. So here's an example. Vegetarians can now enjoy soy versions of bacon cheeseburgers, once considered the sole domain of meat eaters, without any guilt. So I've changed my diet. I'm trying to eat as less meat as possible. So that's something I would probably get. I would get something with tofu in it, something with soy, a black bean burger, or something like that. You know, some companies say, hey, we can be creative. We can supply food to these finicky eaters, and we can make a good profit off of that. So you want to combine how products, services, or other elements, how can products, services, or other elements be combined to create new arrangements, right? So you see all kind of things that are combined in bundles these days. Based on the two top interests of its founder, Sweets and Spurs is a boutique in Norman, Oklahoma, that caters to locals by selling cupcakes and cowboy boots. Well, you know, none other than Norman, Oklahoma, would that be the perfect place to sell cupcakes and cowboy boots. Adapt. How can goods or services be altered to meet new needs? So E.L. James, best-selling British author of 50 Shades of Grey, originally developed the book's ideas as online episodes of fan fiction based on popular Twilight books and movies. James later removed the vampires and reworked and extended the plots of these episodes into a new trilogy. Now the fastest-selling paper, one of the fastest-selling paperbacks of all time. Right, so it's not always the first idea that you come up with. Sometimes it's the second idea. It's this thing called the second right answer. And in that second right answer, you come up with what the answer really is, the best answer. So not just the first good answer that you have, right? So you want the best answer. You want the answer that's going to make you $1 million. You don't want the answer that's going to make you $500,000. So modify. How can products be magnified, minimized, or otherwise given a different shape? Perhaps even less likely to melt in your mouth than in your hands, M&Ms have found new life through their miniature cousins, right? So sometimes you just have to redevelop the size and shape of what your product is, and then you'll find a whole new market. Maybe they were too big before, but I like the size of them now. Put to other uses. How can products created for one use be repurposed for another use? Artists have recently found value in Lego blocks, originally developed for children as a creative medium. Eliminate what can be omitted, deleted, or understated to add value. Although it lacked apps, the ability to play music, and YouTube access, the cordless phone was an impressive innovation when it first hit the market in the 1980s, right? So remember cordless phones? They were like, oh man, it's great, got a cordless phone. And then you had the Zach Morris brick. And now if you carried around a Zach Morris brick, you'd probably look kind of crazy. But then again, cell phones are getting bigger and bigger, so maybe not. Rearrange. Can other layout sequences or other patterns or patterns create value for an organization? The idea of paying first and eating second was likely seen as ridiculous before McDonald's served billions in this manner, right? So before the first person does it, sometimes it just doesn't seem like the greatest idea. Oh, we should pay after we get served. Well, no, McDonald's said no. You need to pay us before you get served. So now let's look at creativity tools in the nominal group technique, because there are different types of technique to be creative. You don't have to go with one specific method in regards to in regards to your creativity. So it generates numerous creative ideas, and it ensures that everyone is heard, sort of like when you do brainstorming. You can't throw out Demetrius's idea just because it's very stupid, right? You have to listen to everybody's idea. Then in your second round, you could throw out my stupid idea. Effective when there is a concern that some people may not be vocal. It builds consensus, and recommended when there is controversy or conflict. So now we're trying to, we have a lot of people who are very emotionally driven by certain things. So you say, you know what, this is how we're going to get down to the nitty-gritty and find out exactly what needs to be done. So here we illustrate the steps of the nominal group procedure. So introduction, briefly welcome participants, clarify the purpose of the group exercise, and explain the procedure to be followed and how results are to be used, right? And you can definitely automatically and immediately use this in your workplace. You want to present question, orally present the question that is written on a flip chart and clarify as needed. Three, you want to have silent generation of ideas. Each participant silently thinks of and writes down as many ideas as possible on a 3x5 card. Allow this for 5 to 10 minutes. Four, you want to record ideas. In turn, each participant reads aloud one idea, and it is recorded on the flip chart for all to see. Five, continue until all ideas are recorded. Six, discourage discussion. Not even questions for clarification. So, hey, everybody be quiet, shut it down. All I want to hear is your ideas. Everybody else should be quiet. I'm sorry about that. Let's get back to where we were. So, you want to encourage what you call hitchhiking or expanding on another statement. Ideas do not have to be from the participants' written list. Eight, participants may pass a turn and then add an idea at a subsequent turn. Nine, discourage combining ideas from individuals unless they are exactly the same. 10, group discussion. After all ideas are recorded, give the person who suggested the idea the opportunity to explain it further. That person now has the floor. And 11, duplicates may be combined. 12, wording may be changed if the originator agrees. 13, delete ideas by unanimous agreement. So now down to step 13, you can throw out Demetrius's crazy idea. And 14, restrict the discussion to clarify meaning. Do not discuss the value or merit of ideas, right? So that's not something that you want to do just yet. You want to get these ideas, you want to take out any duplicates, right? Throw out a couple of the bad ideas, and then we're going to move forward from there. So just a different way to kind of generate creativity. So you need to use passion as inspiration. Engaged employees, which a lot of employees are not, as we know, engaged employees are not just committed. They are not just passionate or proud. They have a line of sight on their own future and the organization's missions and goals. They are enthused and in gear, using their talents and discretionary effort to make a difference in their employer's quest for sustainable business success. That's from an employee engagement report of 2008. Now, if you're a manager, I can guarantee you that you have plenty of employees that are not what you call engaged. But you will have some that are engaged, and those are people that you want to key in on. You want to talk to them about their great ideas and expand upon those ideas and put them to use. Disengaged and dissatisfied employees, and you deal with those every day. 75 to 80% of employees are either disengaged or actively disengaged, right? 75 to 80% may seem like a lot, but that is actually reality. Only 20% feel passionate about their jobs. Less than 15% agree that they feel strongly energized by their work. And only 31% strongly or moderately believe that their employer inspires the best in them. Not great, outstanding numbers for the workforce, but that is definitely reality. So again, we have more lovely discussion questions that I want you to review, think about, ponder on, come up with some answers. So for instance, think about a time when you have been especially creative. What factors do you think help contribute to your creativity? Was it just you sitting there thinking? Was it somebody else who stimulated your creativity? Was it an idea that you just had an epiphany that came out of the sky? You saw it in the clouds and you just went ahead and went along with it. So think about these questions. So stakeholders, remember I mentioned that a stakeholder is somebody who's affected by something, not just a shareholder who has an investment in a company. The American Federation of Labor and Congress of Industrial Organization, or the AFL-CIO, better known as, is a powerful stakeholder as a federation of union that represented over 11 million workers in 2012, right? So that's a lot of people that they're representing. And so they're invested in those, and a vested stakeholder in these different companies because they represent the various unions. Stakeholder mapping. So you look at this and you look at the influence of a stakeholder and the importance of a stakeholder, right? So if the influence is unknown and the importance unknown, and then that's very, nobody's really paying attention to that. But if the importance of the stakeholder, if you have significant importance and the influence of the stakeholder is also significant all the way down right there on that bottom right quadrant, then that's something that you should definitely be paying attention to. Steps in identifying stakeholders. Step one, determine influences on missions, vision, and strategy formulation. That'll definitely give you a key indicator on who's who. Step two, determining the effects of key decisions on the stakeholder. And step three, determining stakeholders' power and influence over decisions. How much power do they truly have? And also, how much influence do they have? You don't have to be at the top of the food chain to have influence over, over decisions, because somebody might hold your opinion in high regard and they may pull your coattails to say, hey, I want to see what you think about this. More great discussion questions. Yes, we're almost done. What are stakeholders and why are they relevant to mission and vision? Well, is your mission, are your stakeholder, is their well-being in the mission and in the vision? Or is it just the shareholders? You have to wonder about that in every particular company, because it could be different for different companies. Developing your own personal vision and mission. So you want to identify past successes. That's good. Say, what did I do that was successful? Write it down. And what was the formula that I did to get there, or that I used to get there? Identify core values. Identify contributions, right? How do I contribute to my workforce? Like, for instance, I'm about to do performance reviews. And you ask, in a performance review, you always ask people to do a self-evaluation. So they want to identify their contributions. You also want to identify goals, because the game just doesn't stop today, right? we're in a United States is a what have you done for me lately type of nation. So you have to identify goals and continue to strive for new goals. You can't just rest on your laurels and say, had a good 2014. I'm going to kick back and relax in 2015. No, you have to continue to have short-term and long-term goals that will continue to inspire you and push you towards doing great things. And you want to write a mission and vision statement. Write it out for yourself. Consider yourself as a company. That's not a stretch or a silly thing to do. Consider yourself as a company and say, these are the things that I want to get done as Demetrius Wilson, Inc. or Demetrius Wilson Corporation. These are things that I want to get done. It will really help you focus on what you're doing in your workplace and sort of reach those goals that you, not sort of, but reach those goals that you put out there. And again, our lovely discussion questions, such as, how does a personal mission and vision statement differ from one created for an organization? Well, it's because it's personalized. It's yours. It's you. It's 100% all you. And I really encourage people to do so. When you sit down, take a couple minutes, think about what you're doing, think about what you want to do, think about what your mission and your vision is, and then you see if it aligns with the company that you're at, and then that will determine if you'll be at that company short term, mid-range, or long term. You can definitely understand that. So this is the end of Principles of Management, Chapter 4, Lecture Part 2. As always, have a good day and a great week.